I don't know what to say, like, wow. Whew. You look beautiful.
Sounds like the guys are
there. Huh? Wow. It's prettier than I remember.
Love you.
Love you too.
I'm so excited.
All
right? Yeah.
Ready to meet your hubby?
Yeah. Ready to see him.
Is he coming up?
I don't know. Soon.
Soon?
Yeah. Yeah.
He's going to be like, I think I've hyped him up so much.
Yeah. Good.
He's ready.
You look nice. You look beautiful. You look really handsome.
Hmm?
Yeah.
You ready?
I'm ready.
Big day.
Big day. Love you.
I'm good. Wow. Hello.
You look good.
You look great.
You look so good. The veil is
definitely a wow.
You love it? Mm-hmm. I love you. I'm so excited for today. You look so nice.
Is it illegal to kiss you?
No, you can kiss me.
That's not illegal.
Love you. Are you chewing gum?
Maybe.
Can you spit out your gum?
It's gone.
Here, let me button you.
I was told by Dunhill, you know, the proper way to wear a tux. No button.
No button?
Yeah.
Oh.
You look okay. Absolutely okay. Stunning.
Thank you. Let's get back.
Yeah. Holy cow. Let me just do the 360. Love it. There's no joking about the train yesterday at the rehearsal. Holy cow. You look great.
I'm so excited.
Oh no.
I love you. Veil's gone.
It's okay.
Thank you. You may be seated. On behalf of Ryan and Mackenzie and their families, I want to thank you for being here this afternoon. We know that some of you have traveled quite a distance to join us, and thank you for making that effort. You know, I think it'd be interesting to go around the auditorium this afternoon and just talk about the way each person here has had an impact on this couple. You affected Ryan in this particular way. You affected Mackenzie in this way. You affected this couple in a particular way. What that means is that their lives and soon to be marriage, it's been enriched by your presence. And you know, the Word of God talks about that. James says that every good gift, every perfect gift is from above, from the Father of lights, with whom there's no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Here's what that means. That means you have been God's gift to this couple. Thank you for being used of the Lord in that way. You know, while all of that is true, Ryan and Mackenzie believe that the most important guest in attendance today is the one who's unseen. It's their triune God. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And while they're very thankful and glad for the rich tapestry and diverse beliefs among many of those who love them, for them, they want to have a wedding ceremony, and much more importantly, they want to have a marriage that it honors God. It's Christ-centered. It's like the Apostle Paul told those at the church at Colossae, Jesus is the head of the body, the church. He's the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. And here's the purpose clause: so that he might come to have first place in everything. Let's pause and commit our time to him, shall we? Our Father in heaven, thank you that we're able to come in your presence this afternoon. And Lord, thank you for being a God who loves us. And thank you for demonstrating that in so many ways, including instituting marriage. Lord, the very first thing you said on this topic so early in the Bible is it's not good that man would be alone. And my friend and brother Ryan especially agrees with that this afternoon. And Lord, that is true. And so you designed marriage so that man and wife could live in a way that would honor you and would bring great pleasure to them. You even instructed that a man would leave father and mother and cleave to his wife, and the two would be one flesh. We praise you for designing marriage. Lord, thank you for giving us a promise-filled book that teaches us how to function in our marriages in a way that would honor you. And Lord, thank you that you thought so much of marriage that when you were looking for a picture to describe Christ's relationship to the church, you chose as one of your examples a husband's love for his wife. Lord, I thank you for each person who's here today, and I do thank you for the way that they have been used in Ryan and Mackenzie's story. And Lord, we now want to commit our time to you. We thank you for what Jesus Christ has done on the cross, making it possible for us to know you and to serve you and to live for you, and even now to rejoice in you. And so, Lord, we pray that we would do that in a way that would honor you. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. You know, whenever you get around such high-quality young people as Ryan and Mackenzie, one of the questions you just can't help but ask is, what kind of influences guided them to where they are today? Scripture teaches that a wise son or daughter makes a glad father or mother. And Tina and Ted and Kathy, Ryan and Mackenzie want to publicly thank you. And we all want to publicly commend you for all of the sacrifice and all of the love that you have poured into these two people. And you know, what a great example of the truth of this passage from the Word of God. Whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. Who gives this woman to be married to this man? You know, I realize that some might wonder if it's even possible for a young couple to put together a marriage that's going to be honoring to God and delightful to them and able to stand the test of time. Ryan and Mackenzie believe that the answer to that question is yes. But in order for you to understand their level of confidence, it's time for me to tell you something scandalous. And please hear me out. But you need to understand that Ryan and Mackenzie have each been married before. And if that's not shocking enough, I need to also tell you that they are each still married to someone else. And I realize that might need a bit of explanation. And so let's leave that to the Apostle Paul, who said in Romans chapter 7, verse 4, "Therefore, my friends, you also have become dead to the law through the body of Christ, so that you might be married to another, to him who was raised from the dead, that we should bear fruit to God." These two young people stand before us in Christ. And understanding that concept is the secret to understanding Ryan and Mackenzie's confidence and hope as they enter their marriage. Now, all that starts with epistemology, which is a rather highbrow word, but we are talking about PhD students. It's a word that means source of truth. How do you propose to know what you know? You see, every person in this room has an epistemology. You've come to a determination about what you believe is true, and we all make choices on the basis of what we believe is true. Well, what is Ryan and Mackenzie's source of truth? They're going to have to decide how to communicate. They're going to have to decide who's supposed to do what in their home. They're going to have to decide about the direction of their life, how to solve conflicts, how to spend their money, what to do with their when they're angry. The questions and the need to make wise choices are going to come fast and furious for sure. Well, what source of truth should they use? And the answer for them is the Word of God. It's the Bible. They would agree with the psalmist who said, "The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is wise, or is sure, making wise the simple." They agree with the Apostle Peter, who said that in the Word of God, they have all that they need for life and godliness. So God's Word is their epistemological source. It's unapologetically their source of truth. So individually, before they knew each other, Ryan and Mackenzie each opened the Bible. And they immediately learned two things. One, that God is really holy. That means he's completely sinless, and he's unable to have a relationship with anything that is sinful. In other words, he doesn't grade on a curve. This isn't Purdue University, so it doesn't work that way. And two, that human beings fall woefully short of that standard. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So what does that mean? That means if we're going to let the Bible be our source of truth, we learn that sin has separated us from our God. That's what explains the emptiness. And that's why we often try to fill that hole with all sorts of things that simply make the separation worse. That's why St. Augustine said, "Thou hast made us for thyself, O Lord, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in thee." So, Ryan and Mackenzie search their Bibles to search for a way to be reconciled to God. And here's what they learned. We can't earn our way to heaven by our own works or our own merit. The problem's just too big. And we can't try to keep a list of laws or standards because we're too weak. And we have the problem of all the ways we've already failed. The bottom line is we need someone who could pay for our sin, and we need someone who could take charge of our life. And the Bible's crystal clear about who that person is. Even as early as the Garden of Eden, God told Satan he would put enmity between him and the woman, between his seed and her seed. And then he said, "Someday you'll be able to bruise him, the seed of the woman, on the heel, but in so doing, he will crush you on the head." In other words, a Savior Messiah is coming. That message became louder and louder as the Old Testament progressed. Friend, if you've never read Isaiah chapter 53 before, if I were the king, every person here would have to do that before they put their head on their pillow tonight. You two are okay, you've read it before, but everyone else, written 700 years before the birth of Christ, and here's what the prophet said: "All of us like sheep have gone astray, each of us has turned to his own way, but the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him." And Ryan and Mackenzie believed that was speaking about the Lord Jesus Christ, the perfect Son of God who died for our sin in our place, who was raised from the dead so that every person who repented and believed in him could have a personal relationship with God. It's not religion. It's not rules. It's not ritual. It's a relationship that is so powerful and so personal. It's likened in Scripture to marriage. And so just like Paul explained in Romans 7:4, Mackenzie has already been married to Jesus Christ, and she always will be. Ryan has already been married to Jesus Christ, and always will be. That's the gospel, the good news of Christ. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. So as they stand before us today, it's in Christ that they stand. It's in Christ that they trust. It's in Christ that they hope. And it's in Christ that they love. Ryan and Mackenzie, I know you're thankful for the gospel and how through Jesus Christ he drew you to himself sometime in the past. And someday in the future, the gospel of Jesus Christ will be your reason to spend eternity in heaven. But this afternoon, I want to challenge you to look for ways to live the gospel every day in your relationship to one another in the here and now. As one writer has said, to learn the art and the discipline of preaching the gospel to yourself every day. So, for example, there will be times when communication is a challenge. And you might, and I'm not talking about you two, but there's some others that need to hear this. And you might be tempted to fall back into patterns or habits or styles of communication that don't please God. Well, when you're tempted to be angry or clam up or be cutting or mean with your words, preach the gospel to yourself. Remember that you're united to the death of Christ. And that means you don't have to continue to sin over and over and over. You can put those sinful habits to death because of the power and the sufficiency of Jesus' blood. There'll be times when you'll be tempted to be selfish, like about every day, wanting everything your way. Well, when that happens, preach the gospel to yourself. Remember that Jesus Christ is resurrected from the dead. Just think about that. He's alive. And therefore, the central issue, Ryan, isn't what you want. And the central issue, Mackenzie, isn't what you want. It's what your risen Savior wants. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. You know, there's going to be times when you don't feel like fulfilling your biblical roles. You know those roles you studied about in premarital counseling? Yeah. Ryan, it's hard to dwell with your wife in an understanding way. That's what 1 Peter commands you, to be a learner of her needs. What that means is you're enrolling in Mackenzie 101 today. And that won't always be an easy class. And it's challenging. Think of it. You're commanded in the Word of God to love Mackenzie like Christ loved the church. You're commanded to be the kind of leader that God desires and commands. Mackenzie, for you as well, to be Ryan's completer. I prayed the verse earlier. It's not good that man would be alone. Look at him. He needs to be completed, and that job is not... Could I get an amen on that? I mean, it's just true. It's just true. It won't always be easy to fulfill your role. It won't always be easy to follow his leadership. You won't always feel like showing him the respect that God's word commands. Well, each time you're challenged, you know what I'm about to say, right? Preach the gospel to yourself. Jesus is alive. He's a sympathetic high priest. He's seated on the throne of grace, and he stands ready to give you all the power that you need to keep the promises that you're about to make to each other. Here's what a gospel-centered marriage sounds like in a nutshell. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. We ask you now to make your vows.
Mackenzie Elizabeth Chapman, I feel extremely blessed and proud to be standing here with you today. I have been looking forward to this day for a long time. From the first time I saw you, I knew that you were special. And after seeing your competitive fire come out playing a board game, I thought this may be too good to be true. You have an unbelievable ability to light up a room and make those around you feel special. I've always admired this about you. You're my best friend, and I promise to encourage and support you in the walk that we have set before us. Mackenzie, I vow to protect you and put your needs before my own. I vow to honor and respect you and be faithful to you and to never take our love for granted. I promise to lead through service and always point our family to Christ so that we may do all things to glorify him. I vow to challenge you and continue to learn and grow with you day after day. I vow to make the love described in 1 Corinthians 13 the love that we experience together. Love is patient, love is kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. And it is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoings, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. I vow to cherish you every day that I have with you, and I will love you until the end of our days.
Ryan Dean Imhoff. Over the last 4 years, I've gotten to know the most amazing man standing before me today. At first, some people may see the tall, athletic, handsome man that you are on the surface, but I've gotten the pleasure to know who you truly are over the last few years, and what a blessing that is. You're a strong leader. You are caring, always putting others before yourself or finding ways to serve someone in any way you can. You're a man of God. I watch your faith flourish as you consistently strive to be in the Word and grow in your walk in Christ. You're intelligent, always correcting my chemical nomenclature. I am so thankful for the people in your life, your mom, your brother, your coaches, friends, and teammates that have helped shape you into the man that you are today, the man that I'm so honored to marry. Today, I give myself to you before God and all of our family and friends here today. I promise to cherish you and to tell you often how thankful I am for you. I promise to be kind, caring, loving, respectful, and trustworthy. I vow to grow with you and to be your partner in all things. I'll love you when it's easy and also when it takes effort. I vow to trust you completely with my heart. I promise to encourage you and support you in all your endeavors. I will love you unconditionally on your best days and on your worst. I will always trust you, and I know you will lead our family well. I vow my life to you. I'll always be your person for today and always know that you will forever be mine. I'm beyond excited to be your wife, Ryan. I will love you from this moment until my last.
Ryan, what do you have as a token of your love for Mackenzie?
Ring.
Would you please repeat after me? This ring I give to you.
This ring I give to you.
As a symbol for you.
As a symbol for you.
And for all to see.
And for all to see.
My commitment to you in Christ.
My commitment to you in Christ.
Until death separates us.
Until death separates us.
Mackenzie, what do you have as a token of your love for Ryan?
A ring.
Well, there it is.
Thank you.
Would you please repeat after me? This ring I give to you.
This ring I give to you.
As a symbol for you.
As a symbol for you.
And all to see.
And all to see.
My commitment to you in Christ.
My commitment to you in Christ.
Until death separates us.
Until death separates us.
You know, in God's very first words in the Bible about marriage, he explained that a man, and a woman should leave father and mother, and the two would become one flesh. That means that a brand new family is being started today, and that's what's being signified by the lighting of the unity candle.
Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. Silent as he stood,
by the authority vested in me in the state of Indiana, and looking to God for divine sanction, I now pronounce you husband and wife. What God has joined together, let not man put asunder. Ryan, you may kiss your bride. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my happy privilege to present to you Mr. and Mrs. Ryan Imhoff.
Put your hands together for Caitlin. Next up, we got Heather and Lucas Vosper. Give it up for Emma, Lindy, and Jack Good. Next up, we have Amanda Porter and Steven Santora. Beautiful evening where we get to celebrate the beginning of a lifelong commitment between Ryan and Mackenzie. So, yeah, that's exciting, right? So many people have traveled from all across the country just to be here today to support them. Or if you're like me, you're just here for the food and those amazing dessert tables. Did anyone see those? They said they're closed till 8, but that's not happening. I think at my wedding we got Costco sheet cake. So, yeah, Mackenzie gets what she wants. Mackenzie and Ryan, I'm really honored to be a part of this small army you call a wedding party. And I'll be honest, I didn't really know you guys had this many friends. So, sorry. I'm just kidding. I also want to thank my mother for putting this amazing and beautiful wedding together. Pretty wowing. She's dedicated the last few months of her life to make this day very special for Mackenzie. Back at home, we refer to her as the princess. So I think you can kind of figure that one out, why we call her that. Everything looks perfect, and it's finally here. Mackenzie, I'm very proud of you and the woman you've become. We're blessed to have Ryan become part of our very large, obviously very large family. Being married over 6 years now, or just almost 6 years, I wanted to give Ryan a few just little lessons I've learned. So I only got three, real quick. So rule number one, never assume anything. Always ask and then confirm. Rule number one. Rule number two, sometimes winning an argument isn't worth it. Just, Mackenzie, you're right. I'm sorry. Even if you are right, you're not right. Rule number three, Mackenzie, I know we all wish Papa Ted could be here tonight, and I think he'd like this last one, or he'd tell you this one. But Ryan, being with Mackenzie for, you know, if you find it difficult to get the last word in the conversation or argument, just know that over time you'll start to realize those last two words are always, yes, dear. So I love you guys, and I'm going to pass it off to Riley.
Wow, that was a good one. Tough to compete there. I'm Riley, and I am Mackenzie's favorite brother. I'm also her older brother, and being her older brother has come with many duties over the course of Mackenzie's life. As kids, me and Elliot were the boundary pushers with my parents and took a brunt of their anger so Mackenzie could be the little angel that you see here today. Trust me, she got way less spankings over the years than we did. Through high school, we were her own personal chauffeurs, sacrificing timeliness nearly every morning for her to get ready for school. The biggest job, though, was the thorough boyfriend investigations. And trust me, Mackenzie kept us very busy when it came to those. As a team, we probably were some of the best detectives in the area, though, and always took all of our results straight back to our mom and dad for them to form an opinion. Ryan was a pretty quick study, though. He's obviously not a small guy. His charcuterie board skills are unmatched, and he's extremely athletic. Just a month ago, we were at Ryan's bachelor party, and Ryan managed to hit a driver 380 yards. It was the furthest drive ever hit at this venue. So that was really cool to see. On top of all of that, he is kind-hearted, a great listener for my sister, mild-tempered, and just fun to be around. As we got deeper and deeper into our investigation, we realized Ryan may be the perfect soulmate for Mackenzie. Mackenzie, you obviously look very stunning tonight. It's been amazing watching you grow into the young woman you are today. Elliot and I are blessed to be able to call you our sister and excited to walk by you through the next stage of your life. If I had to give you one piece of advice, I'd say before any big altercation between you and Ryan, make sure that you think back to when your last meal was. And if it was more than 3 hours ago, then stop, take a timeout, and rethink the argument. Get some food. The hangry syndrome is something that runs in our family, and the first step is always acceptance. Always remember, though, when things are hard and when mom isn't picking up her phone to help, that Elliot and I will always be there for you. Ryan may be bigger than me, but there's no way he can take the two of us. We can't wait to see where God takes you and Ryan in your life together, preferably in the St. John Dyer area. I think my whole family would agree with that one. Elliot and I love you both, and let's party.
Said a lot of people have traveled far for this wedding. We have people from the West Coast, we have people from the southern border, Texas and Florida, and we have Connecticut on the east, and we even have a family from India, which you guys can't trump that, I don't think. We also have a lot of guests from Purdue. One of the special thanks to the Boilermakers out there. Boiler up. Kathy and I have married off two sons. I can tell you that sons' weddings are a lot easier than daughter's weddings. Any of you fathers with unmarried daughters, I have some advice for you that I would just say smile and say, yes, dear. Kathy warned me about being emotional during my speech. I told her, and she told me not to cry. I said I didn't think that was going to be a problem because my tear ducts were almost empty because I had cried for 3 months every time I opened my credit card statement. Ryan, we couldn't have picked a better man from McKenzie. I have a list here of Ryan's attributes. Ryan is loving. Ryan is caring. Ryan is very handy. He's extremely intelligent. He's very handsome. And Ryan, I can't read the next one. He wrote it. Kidding aside, Ryan is awesome. It's wonderful to see him mature in his faith. Sorry. We have no doubt that he'll be a spiritual leader in the household. He actually is very loving, caring. He's pretty handy. He's is very intelligent, but I'm not so sure about the handsome. Mackenzie, she's basically been a blessing her entire life. She's our only daughter, thank goodness. She's our princess and our baby, and she uses all three of those as her, to her advantage. Just ask her brothers, I think they hinted on that, right? She's beautiful on the outside as she is on the inside. She's ambitious, to say the least. Intelligent, also loving, caring, passionate, and thoughtful, and almost perfect. I think she would say, saying with the Playbill theme, she's practically perfect in every way. Your mother and I are so excited for the future for you guys together. We're excited to see what God has in store for you in your careers. I just as a note, I did talk to God, and he said you were going to stay in the region. Thank you, Carson. We hope you enjoy each other as you live out your lives. We only want the best for you. We hope that every day is everything you hope for. We hope the wedding was everything that you planned and wished for. Riley or Elliot mentioned that it would have been nice if Papa could have made it, but God had other plans. And he always teased Mackenzie that he was going to sing Just Because. It's a song by Elvis Presley. I won't dare to try singing it, but I'm sure he's in heaven with a grin on his face and singing it right now. I was going to toast to Mackenzie. I think there's more speeches going, but you know, to Mackenzie. Ryan Mackenzie. I got it. Congratulations, we love you, and have a great time today.
Okay, so I'm Katie. I'm Mackenzie's youngest cousin, and this is such an honor to be here today with her celebrating. For those of you that know Mackenzie well, you know there's so many things I could talk about. I could share one of Mackenzie's awesome qualities, or maybe if you ask her brothers, some maybe not so great qualities. I could talk about the lifetime of memories she has with so many of you. I could talk about her worldwide adventures, including the two countries she was almost arrested for, doing the same exact thing in both countries. But that's a story for another day. Today I decided to talk about who Mackenzie is to me. Mackenzie is someone who has always been there for me, even from the beginning when I was born. I was told the Chapman clan came to see me while I was in the hospital, but they couldn't come in due to Riley, Elliot, and Mackenzie all having the chicken pox. So I was told they looked outside from the window and they waited there the whole day. Throughout high school, she went to all my school plays and as many sporting events as possible, birthdays, and so much more. Due to how crazy busy the Chapman schedule is, this meant so much more to me than she could ever understand. Now, growing up, Mackenzie and I were twins for pretty much our entire childhood. We're a year apart, so anytime we went to church or Busch Gardens or just out for the day, we had matching outfits. Now, when I say matching outfits, I mean head-to-toe matching outfits. We had the same hair accessory, the same shirt, the same shorts, shoes. For church, we had the same matching white gloves. So I don't know when we match today, I don't know if it's because it was ingrained in us at such a young age to just always do it or if we do it for fun. But I like to think we do it for fun now. Mackenzie has also always given me her hand-me-downs. So whatever Mackenzie went through at tomboy stage, I went through it about 6 months later. Mackenzie has always been less like a cousin to me and more of an older sister, which is totally thanks for her mom's having us so close in age growing up, so thanks for that. Now, Mackenzie being my older sister came with the classic older sister's duties. This includes Mackenzie making sure I knew she was older and bigger and could tackle me at any time she felt like it, and made sure to do it every so often. And she also made sure I knew there was nothing I could do to change it. Mackenzie always got to go first in things because she said that she was born first. Mackenzie has always been the one to tell me how it really is. If I'm making a stupid choice, she's never been afraid to tell me right there, right then, no matter how nice it is. She has always looked out for me, whether it be at camp, which was a big thing for her because Mackenzie states she's allergic to the outdoors. She even traveled to Israel with me the day that they moved the embassy building into Jerusalem. She's always been the one that I call for all my big life moments, whether it be moving into a new place, getting engaged. She's always been the first person that I want to know about it. She's always been my inspiration and the smartest person I know. I have always wanted to be more like her. Now for Ryan, as Mackenzie's self-acclaimed little sister, I've always been very skeptical of new guys in her life. But I must say you won me over pretty quick. The first impression I had of you was setting up in this exact room for Riley's wedding, and Mackenzie had bought you a tie that she wanted you to wear. Now, those of you that know Ryan really well know that Ryan doesn't do well being told what to wear. Mackenzie told Ryan told Mackenzie very quickly that he had his own tie and he was more than capable of dressing himself. Now, I knew growing up when Mackenzie wanted something, Mackenzie got something. But I learned at the beginning that, Ryan, you weren't somebody that was just going to tell her what she wanted to wear. You were willing to fight back. And that was what she needed. This is so important, especially in a marriage, because the world will tell you what you want to hear, but you need somebody in your life that's willing to speak truth and love. Ryan, I love getting to know you and watching you and Mackenzie's love grow stronger. I know you love her, and I know you will protect her, as I've seen you physically carry her on multiple occasions and even watched you pick her up on countless times while snowboarding. Something I have learned about marriage is to never stop getting to know each other and never stop trying. There will be days that you might not like each other, and that's okay, but never stop loving each other. I love you both so much, and I'm so excited for the amazing adventure you're about to begin. So let's raise a glass to Mackenzie and Ryan. Hi everyone, and I want to first start off by saying my name is Megan. I am Mackenzie's other matron of honor. As you have heard, Katie and Mackenzie, they have blood relation. Well, me and Mackenzie were commonly mistaken as sisters, but truthfully, we really are just best friends. I promise you, I really do. So, even though our friendship began after a crazy story, which I'll just kind of briefly go over, we began our friendship after she, a freshman, decided to tap me, a junior, on the shoulder during musical tryouts. We both were on time, as typical for both of our personalities. She tapped me on the shoulder because she wanted to use my sheet music that I was very much intensely studying. And yes, timid me, of course, was like, sure, yeah, you can borrow them. Which she decided to then keep the rest of the tryouts. Little did I know at the time, it was the start of a lifelong friendship. What we have learned throughout our friendship is that we're very similar in what we enjoy. Some of the things are musicals, Disney, crafting, and most importantly, our love for ice cream. A favorite memory that I have with Mackenzie is finishing a musical practice, going to Cold Stone, to have Mackenzie intensely shove it in my mouth as I'm driving down the road. How we're still alive, I have no idea. I have no idea. But I know one thing, I'm really glad you tapped me on the shoulder that day. So tonight, I want to say a few words about the friend that Mackenzie is to me. From the day I met Mackenzie, her happy, caring, energetic, confident, and competitive fire, as Ryan would put it, always has been something I admired about her. Through these traits, she was able to help me grow into the person that I really am today.
Every time we're together, I'm reminded that how much she cares for everyone around her to feel special. She will go the extra mile to make sure that you have the birthday party, the bachelorette party, or even some balloons when you're not feeling well. She will do anything to make sure that you know how much she cares about you, even when her day is fully booked. Talking about that schedule of hers, if you've ever been to a Mackenzie birthday party, you know what I'm talking about. There is an itinerary for every single minute. Every minute will be planned, and don't even think about getting behind schedule. So with that said, to follow the schedule, keeping my speech to my allotted time slot, Mackenzie, I have a few words for you. Today is your wedding day. You're happily ever after. You look stunning and beautiful as always. I truly hope that you feel all the love of those around you today. We are here for you and Ryan as you begin this adventure in marriage, and we will continue to pray that God blesses you both in your future together. You truly have a wonderful man. So Ryan, thanks for being the best for Mackenzie, for treating her like a princess, for loving her with everything that you have. And I love you both lots, and I cannot wait for countless more memories with the two of you. So if you could all just raise a glass for the new Mr. and Mrs. Inchoff.
I know it's been said already, but wow, this is a lot of people. I have never spoken in front of this many people, and I feel like I'm about to give a TED talk. I think to start out, I'd like to thank the Chapman family for putting on this amazing night. It's obviously turned out to be beyond beautiful. You guys have put a ton of effort into this night, and from our family, we couldn't appreciate it more. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Ryan's older brother, Tyler. We're here to celebrate the happiest day of his life. He's marrying the girl of his dreams, Mackenzie. My brother's a pretty great guy, but I hate to say it, dude, you got the better end of the deal. She's getting gypped. When the two of us were growing up, I did the best to protect my brother until he was 14, and then he became bigger than me. Much bigger. Frustratingly bigger. All kidding aside, I've always tried to be there for him and to be a constant presence throughout his life. Of course, along the way, there were some brotherly fights and some scuffles, nothing too violent. But even when we did fight, I always knew that we'd be there for each other. I've always tried to be the older brother to him to lean on and look up, and I know, and he can probably attest to it, I'm not always the most talkative. I'm also not always the most sensitive guy. But I like to think I've done my best, and I like to think that that's why I'm here today, and I have the great honor of being his best man. I'm 4 years older than Ryan, and growing up, I've always seen him as my little brother. I don't think it was until the last few years that I realized that he's grown into a mature man, and I like to think that our relationship has grown from big brother, little brother, to also just being friends. Although it's a little hard to realize his maturity, when I think back to all the ass kickings he received and the fits he threw when we played sports like ping pong, I believe it was 43-0 on the scoreboard. Next thing you knew, a fit was thrown, some tears were shed, the paddles were tossed, and the scoreboard came down. He also took a few beatings at basketball, didn't score many points growing up, and punted a lot of balls over the fence. But he's grown up, and he's now much more mature, and I think that a lot of that growth and maturity seems to have come right about the time he met Mackenzie. Not a huge surprise. So thank you, Mackenzie. Over the course of your relationship, my brother has continued to grow with you and mature, and I now realize that I can lean on him for advice and guidance. No longer do I just have to look up to him because of his ridiculous height, but I can now look up to him as a friend and advisor. So in fact, the other night, we don't have moments like this that often because of the distance between us, but we had a chance to chat alone about his upcoming marriage, and he dispensed some of that advice. He explained to me the weight and responsibility that comes with the commitment he's making to be there for someone for the rest of his life, and the excitement with the realization that you have a partner in crime that you can experience your life with. I'd like to say that really struck me, and I can only hope to find someone that makes me feel the way that Ryan feels about you, Mackenzie. Mackenzie, You're the best thing to ever happen to my brother, and I'm sure he couldn't imagine his life without you. I know that my mom and I cannot. I've gotten to know you over the last few years, and I've watched you and my brother's relationship grow. There's no doubt in my mind that the two of you are meant to be together, and I'm also excited to make more memories with the two of you. I'm happy that you've now become my sister, and you can always count on our family to do anything for you guys. And if you ever need any advice on what to do when my brother is irritating the hell out of you, I've got a lot of experience with it, and I'm only a short call away. So Ryan and Mackenzie, you've taken the next step in your relationship, and I'm excited to watch the two of you experience life's many ups and downs and work through them together. So here's the two of you partners in crime. If everyone could please raise your glass, I wish the two of you a lifetime of happiness exploring this world and making a life together. Cheers.
Hi, everyone. Mackenzie and I just wanted to personally thank each and every one of you for coming out here tonight. We'd also like to acknowledge how beautiful does this reception hall look. Come on. This is stunning. We'd especially like to thank a few people. Everyone who's had a hand in this, we have a small army working to make this reception hall look the way it is today. We'd like to thank the Chapmans, Mr. and Mrs. Chapman. We would just like to thank you for hosting such an amazing event tonight. You both have put in countless hours running around with Mackenzie and I, doing all of our odds and ends for the past 5 months. Every weekend, I think, was consumed with wedding planning. Construction projects, the walls, they look great. Mr. C. The church and reception hall just looked amazing. Thank you guys for all the effort you put in. I'd like to thank my mom for all of her hard work that she put in from afar. It's not easy planning and being involved in the planning process from thousands of miles away, but you made it work, and we'd just like to thank you for that. Thank you to all of our wedding party, another small army. Thank you all for all of your support and all of the help with everything. Each one of you has had a big part in getting us to where we are today throughout our lives and also for this weekend. So as Mr. Chapman said, a lot of you have traveled from kind of all over the United States. We have a nice kind of shotgun spread of states covered. So we'd just like to acknowledge everyone that's put in the financial resources, time commitment to being here with us today. This is beautiful, and we appreciate every single one of you for being here with us. And finally, this would not be appropriate of me to give a speech without thanking Mrs. Imhoff right here. All of those little details that you see here today, Mackenzie has thought long and hard about, put in countless hours, some sweat, maybe a tear or two. But it looks beautiful, and she looks beautiful. So just thank you all for being here, and we're so excited to start our life together.
And I just want to reiterate what Ryan said and thank everyone for coming to our greatest show tonight. We love each and every one of you, and we're so excited that you're here. After a few of our dances, well, actually, this is different because the dessert tables are open and they are amazing, and we have cake that's going to come to the tables, and we love dessert, especially ice cream, and a lot of our favorites are over there, so we hope you all can enjoy that. Also on your menus, you'll find what if you have a food restriction, what you're able to eat, and on the back is just a little thank you from the two of us. So, Ryan, I wanted to thank you for just being such an amazing support over the last 7 months. And this, yeah, I'm so excited to marry this man. And so we are so excited to have you all here with us. And let's dance.
Oh. All right, ladies and gentlemen, this time we will invite the new Mr. and Mrs. out to the dance floor to share their first dance together as husband and wife.
Just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off you. You'd be like heaven to touch. I wanna hold you so much. At long last, love has arrived, and I thank God I'm alive. You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off you. Pardon the way that I stare. There's nothing else to compare. The sight of you leaves me weak. There are no words left to speak. But if you feel like I feel, please let me know that it's real. You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off you. That the father of the bride come on out to the dance floor. Let's give it up for once again the father of the bride tonight. As he shares his father-daughter dance with his daughter. Steering wheel, it's the man who hung the moon. It's the road.
tonight.